Meeting of the State Board of Elections. I'd like to call the meeting to order. My name's Peter Kosinski. To my right is Doug Kellner, to my far right, Andy Spano, and to my left is Greg Peterson, the other commissioners. And so we'll start the meeting with the minutes of June 10, 2015. I believe we have two sets of minutes. Could we take them separately? I would entertain a motion to approve the public minutes from June 10.
Second.
Moved and seconded, all in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? They're approved. We then have a separate minutes of the executive session. I personally had asked that these minutes be, I don't know what the word is, but I think they're a little too disjointed, the way they've been presented to us. It's sort of more of a transcript of what happened rather than just minutes. I would ask that they be redone and be just, I don't think there's anything wrong in them, but I just think they're a little hard to follow. I would ask if we could get those in a better format, and maybe we could approve them next time.
Okay.
Any objections to that?
Nope.
Okay. Thank you. So we'll take those up next time.
Who's actually gonna do it?
I'm sorry, who does those minutes? I don't even know.
For the last meeting, I did that.
Okay. Can you just, I just felt it was just sort of a stream of sentences without really consolidating into topics and maybe discussion, and it's a little easier to follow. I thought it was hard to follow.
I know that Doug wanted a little more detail as well.
Correct, I did want the detail, and now we have the tape, so I'm a little more comfortable, but.
I'm okay with the detail, I just think it's a little hard to follow the way it is. Do any of the commissioners have any opening statements before we go to unit updates? Anything? I don't, no, okay. Then we'll go to unit updates, executive. Robert Brem and Todd Valentine.
At the end of last week, the governor signed the presidential primary bill into law, so we have a draft calendar to put together and notify everybody of that. That's actually for April 19th of 2016. And we have two vacancies that we signed to certify this morning that occurred from last week that will notify the counties of those. The 52nd Senate District and what's the other one, Anna? 19th Senate District and 52nd Senate District. And we continue working on our search for the head of the IT unit. We've gone through a round of interviews, and we're looking to make our final selection, hopefully this week. So that's where we're at with that. Bob?
Well, one, I think we should point out, I know we got the news late on Friday, the passing of Commissioner Rodney Gabell in Sullivan County. He had a stroke about 10 days ago, I think, Anna, 2 weeks ago. The reports were that he was making progress, but late Friday he passed. So one, I wanted to bring that to your attention. We all send our best wishes and condolences to his family. A number of items that are in the units have certainly occupied our time. The political calendar for the presidential, we've shared, and the proof is ready now that the bill has been signed. I think our attention is next to the June federal calendar that we have to deal with, because it was not part of the legislative session. So Todd and I have talked, Anna and her people have put together a draft outline to share so we can start working for the unified application to Judge Sharp is to set that calendar next. So we hope at the next meeting or shortly thereafter to have that ready for you. We wanted to wait and make sure the legislature didn't address some of the issues while they were dealing with the presidential primary, which they didn't. So I think that's the main issue that is before us.
And one other thing to mention, new, since the last board meeting, was the Deputy Director of Election Operations, Brendan Lovallo, is joining us this morning.
Welcome.
Welcome, Brendan.
Lovallo.
Okay. Anything else from the executive?
No?
Then Council, Compliance, Kim Galvin, and Kathleen O'Keefe.
Thank you, Commissioner.
the routine work of the unit keeps us busy with the compliance reviews and the increase in calls that we've been receiving. There's also been many calls from county boards of elections regarding the upcoming elections and just people and candidates in general. A couple of cases have been filed as a result of the JD filing period that just passed. Those are ongoing in court. The board has traditionally taken a no position in those. There's been a couple other lawsuits that have been filed against the board. I imagine we'll be talking about one, at least in executive session, that was filed by the Brennan Center. And there was another one that challenged the rules of a new party. So those have required a little bit of attention. We have been having internal meetings amongst the units and together and with enforcement. We had one to try to work through some of the workflow and communication issues that we have. They seem to be productive. We have proceeded with, and Brian and Bill have done a series of hearing officer interviews with the candidates that apply for those positions. Is there one left? There's one interview left to be had. We've had some new staff start in the compliance unit. They're being trained and brought up to speed on their various duties. And we've been trading drafts on some of the opinions that have been requested of the board. It's been busy, but I'm sure Anna will talk about the petitions and the hearings on the same, but it's been busy, but we seem to be moving everything forward.
Yeah, Kim hit a lot of the high points. We had our July periodic report was due on the 15th. It's obviously resulted in an increase in phone calls and inquiries as to our call center, as well as issues regarding termination, resignation, and so forth. I want to bring this to the board's attention. The New York City Campaign Finance Board filers have a catch-22 that we've recently discovered. It's a software issue. Maybe we can develop some kind of proposal down the road that may address some of that concern. We could possibly do that in regs. We are doing our legislative audit. That is underway. That's the two-year and four-year audit to look for over-contributions.
I'm sorry. Can I just interrupt?
Sure.
Can you elaborate a little bit on that catch-22?
Sure. The software for the Campaign Finance Board has certain requirements. Now, presumably, they're dealing with the same facts, the same documentation, whether they file here or they file there. However, the software itself asks for certain fields that are not completely identical between the two programs. And as we know, our program is very old. Apparently, this was just discovered last week. Apparently, when people do their filings, these are the New York City folks, they do their filings and there's a checkoff box, do you want us to forward your filing to the State Board of Elections? And they've been routinely checking off that box. The problem is when the Campaign Finance Board then does that, they launch it to us, it disrupts what was otherwise filed here and makes it non-compliant. So we need to perhaps think about telling them to remove that box rather than have the Campaign Finance Board do it.
Let me understand this a little more clearly. So I'm a filer in New York City.
Right.
I have to file with the Campaign Finance Board because I'm taking public money down there.
Right.
I also have to file here.
That's right.
So are you saying that these people file here and there at the same time?
Yeah. Yes.
But they file a bit of a different filing because there's some different
fields. Right.
So they've already filed here.
Right.
But then the Campaign Finance Board, when they forward the filing that was done down there,
it
disrupts what's here, what's already here.
No,
exactly.
Not here at all yet.
I'm sorry.
The Campaign Finance Board is acting as an intermediary, if you will, to forward, once they hit file with the CFB, CFB says you want us to send it to the state.
Okay. Right, but my understanding is that what happens is in translation, it's not correct here. In other words, now I was under the impression they were doing some filing here, and I may be wrong about that. But the bottom line is they are allowing people.
Too many pronouns.
They are allowing the
no,
Campaign
don't
Finance
use
Board.
Pronouns.
The Campaign Finance Board is allowing people to check this box to get the filing done automatically.
Gotcha.
There's a possibility here of fixing this very easily, and I think it could be done by reg, which would be to have the board consider eliminating people that have to file at the campaign finance board from actually filing here. It's sort of the reverse of what was done with local filers, where local filers can opt to file here instead of locally. Is that ideal? It's probably not ideal, but until we have our new program, our new computer system, and I'm not even sure at that point if it will resolve it, but at least at that point we'll have an operating computer system that could potentially speak to the campaign finance board's computer system.
So what happens right now, so they file with the campaign finance board, I assume they put it up on their website, then the filing is sent to us. What happens to it here? It just goes nowhere? It's rejected?
It gets uploaded, but it looks deficient.
Oh.
That's the problem, is then they're getting deficiency notices from us.
Because why does it look deficient to us?
There's some kind of inability to translate the, and we have filers that file here that run into the same thing. They use Aristotle or, what is it?
NGP.
NGP. There's a couple other programs out there that when they file with us, we've seen things like you report one contribution from a partnership, and instead of it just being one number, they attribute it to the whole partnership. So it looks like you have this massive overcontribution. So there are glitches in the computer systems that are being used by some committees to make the filing that don't really speak coherently with our computer system.
The difference is Aristotle and those companies will work with us to work through the glitches, where Campaign Finance Board isn't necessarily amenable to changing their system to accommodate us.
So we have to change our system to accommodate them.
We're sort of exploring what's really going on at this point.
I'm not against that if that's what we have to do, because we are in the midst, I know, of creating a new system anyway.
Right.
So, I mean, if part of that accommodates this problem, that makes sense to me, but I realize that's not happening tomorrow either.
Right.
That's not happening for a while. So I guess in the meantime, what is the solution?
Right. Well, this just really was discovered in the last couple of weeks. And now that we're doing deficiencies, obviously we don't want people to get deficiencies when it's really just a computer issue. So we're in the middle of trying to figure this out.
Right. There's several issues. Like, for instance, one of the big issues in New York City is they have what the concept called advance repayments. So when the campaign gets money fronted, if you will, through the public matching, how that then gets translated to our reporting isn't necessarily the same. So while it might be sufficiently detailed for the campaign finance board's filings, when our auditors do the review, we don't have the necessary level of detail. So the people who are filing with the campaign finance board are saying, well, I'm filing it. It's compliant, so to speak, with the CFB, but it's not necessarily compliant here. Also, for instance, New York City has been exploring through regulations allowing for text messaging, contributions, and certain things like that, where depending on how people receive those things, we may not have that type of contribution listed as a choice in our software, so when people file them, and so where do you get the parity or accommodation and those types of things. So we're in the process of having some of those discussions to determine how we can have the compatibility work so that both sides of the filings can work. And also, to Kathleen's point, I want to clarify, though, that the local filers don't have an option. They can't opt into filing here. It's whether they do or they don't. But certainly, to her point about the filing and the duplication, that certainly might be something we could address.
Can I just say, it seems a little surprising. It just came to our attention. Hasn't this been going on a while? Did they make a change down there that caused this? Or why is this now coming?
They made a change, but you have to remember that with the advent of the compliance unit, where we're now looking at all these reports very specifically, a lot of these issues with the filings would have been loaded and filed, and you wouldn't necessarily have noticed them because they weren't being reviewed to that level of detail, whereas now they are. So,
also, people that are doing filings often have consultants, and the consultants are now saying, what does the state board mean you have to, you know, amend this deficiency? This is ridiculous. It's a software issue. So as people are giving us feedback, we become more aware of how these two systems are working or not working together.
So I have a few questions.
Oh, sure.
I saw the draft annual report, and for the compliance unit, I did not see the same level of statistical detail that we used to have in the prior reports with the number of committee filings and the number of committees that were brought to court and the amount of judgments and judgments collected. And I believe that this is all information that we provided to the Moreland Commission, so that the statistics are there. I just don't know who is responsible for that section of the report. And I would ask that draft annual report be revised to include that statistical detail.
Just to clarify for you, Commissioner, I don't know why that draft report was sent out, because it has not been completely reviewed by Kim and I. It went out to the commissioners unbeknownst to me. I have it on my desk, yeah, well, and I've already...
But that might have been a good thing, because the report's like 6 months overdue.
No, so. I agree, but the fact of the matter was that the report was launched without any staff sign-off for that to happen. I mean, we are in the middle of actually doing this. Now, I have not participated in an annual report in the past. I do know that the piece that has to do with the council's unit and the compliance unit needs significant work, because it's a brand new unit. So obviously, with a new unit, you're going to have a significant amount of additional work versus units that have been in existence. Well, so
The goal is to get the 2014 annual report done before 2016.
Yeah, that's very true.
All right, well, maybe that's for the executive directors to take up who's going to do that. But I want the statistical information, and I don't care that the pictures of the commissioners are also out of date. But maybe Commissioners Kosinski and Spano would be more interested in that.
I mean, it is going to be a partial snapshot, because the staffing and the level.
Obviously, it changed in September, but the point is to at least keep up the level of statistical detail that we had in prior reports, and so there's a baseline for the public to evaluate what's happened. All right, so that was one. Next is there were the two lawsuits regarding the Women's Equality Party. What's the status of that litigation now?
Both lawsuits were commenced in different counties, Nassau and Niagara. The one in Nassau County has now been discontinued, voluntarily discontinued. The one in Niagara is returnable August 6th, I believe. We have agreed to take no position here. Both sides are represented by counsel. I understand that they are in the process of submitting briefs to the court on the merits, as well as a motion to change venue.
And the board is not taking a position.
That's right.
And then the limited liability company lawsuit, that is returnable August 7th. And I understand, was it Kim wanted to ask for
I did
additional
ask for an
time?
Extension.
And I said I had no
with the
problem
consent,
with that.
Yeah, obviously.
Have you heard back from them?
I have not. I heard back from the Mr. Celli, who said that he wasn't handling the day-to-day, but that I would hear from one of his partners, and that they were agreeing to, it seemed like they were agreeing to work with us to give us some time based upon a variety of factors, but I suspect that will be today or tomorrow that I'll hear from them, or I'll call them back.
All right.
And the return date's the 7th, but papers
are due the
3rd.
I think Commissioner Spano and I still have the same views that the board's position is incorrect, and we would still like the board to revisit that policy. Mm-hmm. So I would ask the commissioners to consider revisiting the LLC policy again. I think many of the arguments that are laid out in the lawsuit are correct, and that we should not stand on a policy that's outmoded and probably has an incorrect reading of the statute.
Well, to be fair, I understand we discussed this a couple months ago, a lengthy discussion, and I think we came to a final vote, which I think we stand by. So I realize the lawsuit's now been commenced, and I think we'll be in court defending those positions that the board took, and the court will do what it'll do, I guess. But I don't know that there's any basis. I don't have any basis myself to revisit the issue, since I don't think anything has changed since August 16th. So I don't know why we revisit.
Why do you have additional work, you have additional expenditure possibly, and we'll lose this lawsuit.
Well, ordinarily, we talk about these in executive session, so I had a lot of arguments to make, but if you're choosing to do it publicly, I can make my arguments now.
No, I don't mind waiting for executive session.
I think if we're talking about litigation strategy, we'd be better off in executive session, so we can talk freely.
All right, well, I just wanted to be on the record that with my position, and I guess I've said it, and I believe Commissioner Spano agrees with me.
Okay.
All right, then my last set of inquiries here is, is the compliance unit making formal referrals to enforcement of the non-filers?
We have provided Lisa with everything up to, I think, the July, this month's filing. All the non-filers for candidates and party committees, I believe. We have not done the PACs, we can add that. And then we have not run the July 2015 one, but everything previous to that was provided.
And has a regimen been developed yet on how to deal with over-contribution referrals and who's going to do what with respect to determining over-contributions?
We have agreed to do the candidate the compliance unit. The counseling compliance unit has agreed to do the over-contribution audits for candidates, which we are in the middle of doing now. So it's the 4-year statewide and the 2-year state ledge.
Yeah, we feel that those are actually real compliance type issues, right, to look at those filings to make sure they're given a compliance look.
Right.
And then is the plan to make referrals to enforcement?
Right. Well, these folks, similar to what happens with a regular compliance review where you let folks know you've got some kind of deficiency, we're letting people know. A letter will go out. We haven't done it. It's a massive audit, obviously. A letter will go out and basically say, here is where you've taken an over-contribution, and this is what you should do to correct that. And there is a mechanism the board has used historically in that regard, and then we get copies of the checks, making the refund, and so forth. So we are actually in the middle of doing that. The other thing that we're in the middle of doing, and the staff has had some pretty interesting discussion about, are the deficiency referrals. Deficiencies run the gamut from you're missing one address to you have a negative balance. I mean, deficiencies are along a very broad spectrum. And we've spoken to the enforcement unit. We gave a deficiency list to RESA, and with the suggestion that Kim and I both agreed to say, do we want to try to classify deficiencies in a way that is sort of de minimis, which the statute does sort of recognize you can have de minimis deficiencies, versus what are significant or substantial deficiencies. So we actually have Cheryl and Bob, who are the heads of the compliance unit, going through all of the deficiencies in one filing and using that as basically a pilot, sort of our own, to say where do these various deficiencies fall in on the spectrum. What we hope to do is share that information with RESA, and if we can come to some kind of meeting of the minds, it'll give us a much better idea down the road of what the Enforcement Council is interested in seeing.
Right, and just to supplement that, when we had met with RESA and the Enforcement Unit, we all agreed, I think, theoretically, that, you know, missing one address and a multi-page filing might not be something they would be interested in. So when we forwarded those, we offered, if they wanted, for us to go through them and classify them and what we thought were, you know, missing an address, missing a zip code, those sorts of things. And then hopefully we could come to a threshold agreement so that would cut out a great deal of work and letters that we've heard from various elected officials too. I mean, you're sending me a letter for one missing address and you're doing this for that, and it'll ease the burden on the compliance unit, yet we have agreement with enforcement that it will be something that, you know, we'll still send a training letter or whatever to notify them of that deficiency, but we won't waste a lot of time for something as de minimis as a zip code or a missing address or something like that.
And also our concern is we should not be telling people this is a de minimis issue, just address it the next filing,
right,
like a training issue. If the enforcement unit doesn't agree with that, we're setting people up for problems,
right,
and we don't want to do that.
Regulations.
You're taking my whole report from me, Commissioner.
Oh, did I interrupt you? Finish, go ahead. I'm sorry.
Okay. We sent out a postcard before the July 15 filing to all treasurers and candidates, advising them and reminding them of their July periodic filing. It's brought certain issues to the forefront regarding candidates that do not have to make a filing, but that our system captures them because their names are appearing on, say, constituted committee lists, things like that. So again, this is a new step we're taking, trying to give people a heads up before the filings due, and we are discovering issues that now we need to address with respect to how our compliance reviewers and the call center are answering certain questions.
And the notice is going to a increased amount of people,
right.
Not
almost
just
8,000, right.
Yeah.
Yep. So, and then our compliance webinar was provided on July 9th and the 22nd. It's going to be provided again on the 26th of August. The webinar is an introduction to the compliance unit and outlines our top deficiencies and our training issues and how to correct them. Again, with the eye towards really identifying the things that have given people the most trouble. Staff has been providing regional seminars and CLEs across the state in the last several months. The seminar schedule's on the website, and we have another one scheduled in Albany for August 19th. Kim had mentioned we have three requests for advisory opinions from the board, what they have to do with rentals and a marketing firm and corporate subsidiaries. We're in the process of finalizing those three opinions to give to the commissioners. We spoke about the lawsuit. We've had the LLC lawsuit. We've had a very serious uptick in subpoenas that are being served on the board, which is creating a significant amount of additional work for the staff.
Yeah.
We're
and
still
FOIL requests as
and
well.
And FOILs, right. We're still waiting to get a final clerk appointed who would be doing a lot of the subpoena work and the FOIL work. So we're hoping to get that done soon. Our public financing report has been completed. We will circulate that to the commissioners. I understand in the past that has not something like that has not required a board vote, but we will be sharing that memo. I have prepared a memo on the PAC independent expenditure issue that the board raised at the last meeting. The issue really does not lend itself easily to a yes or no answer with respect to can PACs do independent expenditures. And the memo that I prepared, which I've shared with Kim, really is hopefully a prompt for a policy discussion by the board. I think we can look at what the state statute says and what it doesn't say, and perhaps give some guidance in either a board opinion or in regulations to help people, particularly with the coordination issue. Regulations, just briefly, we have independent expenditure regs. They have been published, and the comment period is over. These are ready to be adopted. We can add some additional regs into this area that will reflect a recent change in the statute, the possible penalties, which the current regs do not address, and any other issues that may be raised in our PAC independent expenditure discussion. So that can come at a later date. Our contribution limit regulations have been published. The comment period expires on August 1st, so we think we can present those to the board to be adopted at the next meeting. The hearing officer regs and subpoena regs, we understand are ready now to be filed. We will do that in the next couple of days. Moving that along, that's the hearing officers that would be used by enforcement. And
quarter to 12.
Right. And we have, we've talked in the past, but we have not moved forward on this, but I just want to mention this. Maybe we can bring it up again at the next meeting if we have some movement here. We talked about amending our HABA regs to reflect the fact that we're looking to keep those regs on this side of the board rather than in enforcement, and we would need to have proposed amendments to do that. We talked about the de minimis list already. Kim mentioned about working with enforcement, trying to communicate better. I think we've made significant inroads in that area. Communication, maybe not cooperation, but communication. And the recognition that a committee can be dealing with both enforcement issues and compliance issues at the same time. So we're trying to work out how we let each other know that, you know, something may be going on. For instance, if an enforcement matter is pending in some manner and somebody does a filing, that's now in compliance, and we're doing that review. So we are trying to figure out how we can let enforcement know that is actually happening.
Even if it's something as simple as putting COMP in the filing database that enforcement can access, so they know we're doing something over there as well.
Right.
Over here.
And then Kim mentioned two new staffers that we've have. Our compliance unit is complete except for the clerk. And I just want to mention one nice little piece of information that can make us all feel good about our staff. This year, the board had 14 participants in the CDPHP Workforce Challenge, enabling us to have a men's team, a women's team, and a co-ed team. Each team then designated a, quote, CEO to reflect the most senior person in the organization that participated in the run. Our CEO designee, Bob Eccles, came in first place for the CEO representing a state agency at this run. So we were pretty impressed by that, and I just want to give him a shout out. And that's it.
Do you think that the new computer system we're putting in will diminish the number of FOILs we get?
Let's hope that's the case. I mean, it depends on if, well, a lot of the stuff, though, that we have on our website is the most recent. I don't know what the decisions are made about the older.
I would imagine that there are certain, there's certain information that will still not be on the website, so there will still be a FOIL request for that. We do sometimes get requests for information that has to do with the filings that might be somewhat onerous for someone. If they want to download all of the data and kind of parse through it themselves, they may ask for a subset of that data. When the new reporting goes into place, they will be able to kind of search through that kind of subset and then also export it themselves, so they wouldn't need to come to us for it.
Right, certainly the amendments, well, that'll be a huge one. Right now you have to request amendments because only the most recent report filed for a particular filing period shows on the website. So the new system, every time you file an amendment, you'll see each one as a standalone. So from that standpoint, presumably they'd be able to download those, but you wouldn't have communications and other types of documents.
That's registration documents.
Registration documents.
Do you have to merge anything if PBLS were, in other words, create the document through taking digital aspects of it?
For the most part, none of that, any of the information that comes to us in a document form, we wouldn't be manipulating in that way. Any information that's being sent to us in electronic form, which is kind of going into a database, the reporting functionality that we'll have in the new system will allow a little bit more robust functionality.
Can they FOIL it? And ask you to
they
do
don't
that?
Even need to FOIL it, they'll be able to export it themselves.
With the independent expenditure regulations, our emergency regulations expire, so we either have to continue the emergency regulations or adopt the regulations that have been published.
Right, we could adopt the emergency ones again. We have 365 days to actually adopt the permanent regs that are in the works already, but the emergency ones have expired as of last
week.
Did
we get comments on the ones we put up?
We had no comments.
No comments?
No comments.
We had them out for informal comments on the website before we did this.
Yeah, we got
the comments at that point.
Right. Oh, you do?
But during the form, well, just because it started last year.
I don't know if I saw those.
It started with the adoption of the budget last year, so.
NYPIRG gave comments. I don't remember.
Right, when we adopted the emergency.
Could I get copies
of the informal one? Sure.
Yeah, I'd like to see those before I vote on finals. I'm okay with extending the current ones if we have to. I think I would just like a little time to look at the comments before we finalize them.
We'll try to do that next meeting.
To finalize, yeah, I think we should. But in the interim, if we want to just extend the emergencies till then, I think that might be a good idea.
All right, I move that we reenact the emergency independent expenditure regulations as published on our website.
I second. Second. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Okay, so I would anticipate that in the next meeting, we would have the final ones here we could adopt. Now,
and just so for the comments we got were like last summer when we were adopting the emergency the first time.
Fair
so
right.
So
right.
Certainly since we've been going up for the
now, there's been a statutory change as well.
Correct.
In the interim. So how are we going to accommodate the statutory change then?
Well,
I assume those aren't reflected in these.
That's correct. Well, I think the statute is consistent with the regulations, but Kathleen's memorandum on political action committees and independent expenditures raises the issue of whether we should add an additional section to the regulations spelling out the indicia of coordination. So,
and just for clarification and not anything else, we got that yesterday, the draft.
Right.
I'm just letting the commissioners
okay,
know
no,
why
fine.
They don't have it.
Right.
You're
that's
referring
fine.
To a document they don't have yet.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, well, I thought Kathleen did an excellent job on the draft, and it raised the issue to me of whether we ought to include in our regulations, which would require re-noticing them, and you know, it's a whole big deal. Whether you enact the existing proposal and then amend them again, or whether you
aren't we going to have to amend them again anyways because of the statutory change, or no?
The statutory change is minor in two definitions, and then the original regs. And I wasn't here then, so I don't know what the decision was about this, but it doesn't include anything on the possible penalties that people can face. So we might want to consider doing something with that.
So we're probably going to do an amendment to these regs
that's what
anyways?
It says,
is
right.
That your guess?
That's what I think.
And
right.
You know, I think we could discuss the issue of independent expenditures in that context. If we come up with some guidelines for people, I think that's helpful.
I think it would be helpful to write in the regs some guidelines on indicia of coordination.
I think there are some entities that have done that. I believe, isn't the City Campaign Finance Board done something like that?
Yes.
Yes.
And I believe.
And
I
Kathleen's memo does go into some of the court cases on it. But,
okay.
But I think that it would be helpful to have actual guidelines. I don't know that you can do a bright line, though. That's the biggest problem with this whole area.
Yeah. No, I understand. It is a somewhat a case-by-case analysis, I understand. So.
Which is very tough on an enforcement statute.
It is.
Because
it is.
You
it is. But I do agree with the concept of having people understand what the basic rules are, because I think it's not fair to have people out there acting without really knowing what the rules are. So if we can do that, I think that'd be good. So I look forward to seeing Kathleen's memo, and then we can discuss that going forward. But I think at the next meeting, our goal should be to at least enact the current independent expenditure regs in that form, and then we can look to amend them. Was there anything else from the council compliance unit? Do you have any other questions?
Thank you.
Okay. We'll go on next to the election operations. Anna Savitzro.
Thank you, Commissioner. We've been briefing Brendan. I'm sure we've inundated him with more than he ever wanted to know about election ops, but he's been holding up his end quite nicely. We submitted a written report, but I didn't see it in the board packet, so I'm happy to go through it with you now. We completed designating petitions. 90 petitions were filed.
To interrupt, Andy. You have a written report?
I do.
You don't have any copies of that I could look at with you by any chance? Or?
We submit that to be included in the packet.
I didn't see it either, though. Anna mentioned it. I didn't see one either, so.
If you want to give us a second, I'd be happy.
Would you mind? I mean, it would be nice if I could just follow along with you. Maybe it would be easier than.
Sure.
Go ahead, though. I don't want to.
In the meantime, the only petitions that were filed with us this year were for judicial delegate and alternate delegates, and some state committee filed with us. Most of that filing is done locally, so I don't want to swamp you with statistics.
When did those come in?
July 12th was the last day to file.
Yes.
And did we receive objections to some?
We had 5 sets of objections. Those are reviewed on your prima facie report, which is in your packet. Brendan and I prepared that for you for your consideration.
I guess we'll take that up later, so I don't want you to get into the details.
There are court cases stemming from these objections already in motion, but we don't have much information on the status of that particular effort. We are working with NYSTEC. We continue to work with them to revise procedures. We expect to have a draft on the hash checking of the New York State Technology Enterprise. It's the outfit that was created by the legislature when they were closing the bases in the Utica area. Mm-hmm. they turn them into technology experts, and they're very good. They're our consultant, have been since we got started with HAVA.
And the machines, they did our security stuff with the machine certification.
So they are working with us on, right now, we submit test plans to them for any of the functional testing that we do. We submit, obviously, the security aspects of source code for any of the certification that we do. At present, they're helping us with procedures that reflect county board use of the systems and comments that we've gotten back. A lot of those procedures have already been done and posted. What NYSTEC is working on now is the procedure for the inability to do hash checking on COTS systems. We talked about that, I think, one or two meetings ago. So we'll have a draft, we were told, I think, on Friday, and Brendan and Bob were both out of town then, that we'll see a draft this week, and then we can deal with that internally and hopefully have that to you at the next meeting. Brendan and Bob and John Ferry just came back from Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. Bob and John were asked to make presentations to the elections team there, the Secretary of State and their election administrators. There were representatives from Carnegie Mellon there, from the EAC, from
California,
thank you. And Brendan can comment further on what went on at that session. They're concerned that their certification testing isn't robust enough, and the Carnegie Mellon folks are concerned about security. Ironically, I heard from both Brendan and Bob this morning, because they got back late Friday night, there wasn't much conversation about the accuracy and integrity of the system counting votes. It was all about hacking and securing the system from seals and locks and that kind of aspect. So we usually start with one and go to the next, and they seem to have gone the other way. But it was, I think, an honor to be asked to participate, and our presentation went well. Brendan can comment further if you have more questions for him. The statistics on the petitions are on the report that you have in front of you. 276 delegate candidates and 247 alternate delegate candidates filed here. And what we're collecting now is all of that same information that was filed at the county boards of elections. We have to do all that data entry and then prepare the official roll calls for the state committees that are reorganizing this year, and also for all of the judicial conventions for all of the parties that are conducting those this year. We're anticipating four primaries, but the number of primaries will depend upon the results of the court cases that we mentioned earlier. But we are going to have a drawing. We anticipate those are the primaries, and we draw anyways if they end up not appearing in a primary due to the decision of the court, then we just move on from there. We'd rather do that than have last-minute drawings. We are working with the IT department concerning the candidate management system to make sure that it reflects the kinds of issues that we've been dealing with in the past and that those can get resolved in the new version. We continue to work with Clear Ballot. We haven't done functional testing yet. We've been doing preliminary dry run testing on that system, but we're waiting for a new build and some changes that were prompted by our findings and conversation with NYSTEC. But that does seem to be moving forward. We worked on separating, for your consideration today, the central count system upgrade for Dominion from the balance of their upgrade. The central count system stands alone. It is a new system, so the counties that purchased it still have 5-year warranties. The system was only certified last year, so they're well in their warranty period, and any upgrade would go to them at no charge. We are working on a recommendation for this board concerning the balance of the Dominion upgrade and the issue of version control, version management that was discussed at some length at the last board meeting. So we hope to have a recommendation for you at that at the next board meeting. We We made our conversion from our county board info portal, which was an FTP site, to a SharePoint site. That's been somewhat seamless, not without its issues, but all of the information is there. The site is a lot more stable. It's a lot more accessible to the county boards. Periodically, that FTP site was not available to them, and we rely on it. All of their procedures are on that site. The guide to operating a board is on the site, record retention guide, sample forms that they'd be needing for petitions, such as acceptances and declinations, and similar forms are on that site. If you would like access to that site, we can send you an invitation. I think that's how it works for SharePoint. Mm-hmm. So we can do that. Just let us know if that's what you would like.
So this is an internal site that only county boards and the state board have access to?
Yes. I did not have anything else.
Can all the counties look at all the other counties? Can they all look at each other?
Well, there isn't county data on there. It's only procedures. It's the guide on
how. So it's our stuff?
Right.
It's a one-way.
Oh, so the counties don't put their procedures on the web?
No.
Correct.
So it's only our procedures we recommend to them?
Right.
So we don't have access to county-created documents?
We do when we do board visits. We collect those. We keep them here. We don't post them anywhere. We use them as a resource.
I mean, why doesn't this portal, or whatever you call it, have that information on it? So if Westchester County has a set of procedures, why aren't those up there too? So we can look at those and know what they're doing and review them or whatever, you know, would be appropriate.
We never intended it for that purpose, but because we're collecting the procedures in a separate project.
I mean, why wouldn't this just be an easy way for the counties to communicate with each other as well as with us? I mean, I know we have these conferences once a year where we meet and talk about things, but why couldn't this be an ongoing sort of, for better word, conversation where counties can share with each other over this portal, as well as with us, something, you know, that would be accessible to them and they could then share and review?
We can do that. We have them here. All we have to do is scan them and upload them. That would not be a problem. And then every county would be able to look at every other county's procedures.
Yeah, I mean, is there any downside to that? Is there any?
Other than shaming boards that don't have procedures into actually developing them? No, not at all.
That's a good thing. It's not a downside.
No, not at all. Not
well, they can learn from
mind.
Each other. That's just been my experience, you know.
Right.
If a county has a good set of procedures, everybody should follow them.
We have posted
them. Yeah.
Some of those, and I'll use Essex County as an example. Would not think that a small county like that would have an extensive contingency plan, but their contingency plan is 60 pages long. Every press outlet in the county, every county emergency person they need to reach out to, every IT resource that might be available to them if there was ever an issue with their own system being down or scanners being out. It is an incredible contingency plan, and we've shared that with a lot of county boards, and that one is posted on our website. We reference it in our own recommended contingency plan procedures. But sure, we're happy to do that. We can scan those and post them by county, and hopefully the upside would be that counties would get with the program.
I think the only downside might be we might disagree with some of the procedures that the counties employ.
Well, we'd have to put a disclaimer
up might
there.
Copy.
Right,
yeah.
A disclaimer.
What I was going to say.
Well, do we have
a
set of best management? Do we have a set that we recommend to the counties would be a good?
Yeah.
Most of our procedures relate to the use of the voting systems, the new systems, the scanners, and that kind of thing. They really don't relate to day-to-day operational procedures, how to handle the mail, phone calls, things like that. That did probably a good reason why we didn't post all of the county board procedures there. And some of our county boards mistake how to process something, for example, through their vendor for their voter registration system, as opposed to a procedure on how to register a voter. It's not turn the system on, click this button, you'll see the screen and go ahead. There really has to be an evaluation of the voter registration form, the bipartisan review of it and acceptance of it. Same thing with absentee applications, that kind of thing. So
We get best practices.
Well, yeah, we do that at conferences, and we post all of our conference presentations on the website, so that's...
Well, I think it'd be an excellent idea to have a central place where all the county procedures are posted. And Kim, you know, the board has authority that we can override any county procedure. We don't do it very often. I can only think of once in the last 3 years that we've done it, but we have that authority to formally tell them to change their procedure.
Well, I mean, I think we have a responsibility to be interacting with these boards, and if we see them going in a direction we don't agree with, we should be in contact with them. Mm-hmm. We should be notifying them and telling them why and convincing them why they should change. So I think we have a responsibility here.
And that's a great segue into my next question. I'm going to continue harping on this every month, but what's happening in terms of bringing New York City into compliance with the 30-minute rule for the November 2016 election?
I'm probably not the person you want to have answer that question. I'll defer to Bob and Todd.
Well, we did it, as we said last time, we had reached out to, Todd and I had gone to New York City to meet with one of the councils to the mayor and with the Dawn and Mike Ryan from the city board on plans they were putting in place. We did a follow-up conference call Anna also was in on, where we asked a series of questions. Where are they in their planning? There are a number of, as they described to us on the phone call, there are a number of plans that they're putting in place that they want to see at the primary, how well they work, maybe make modifications in time for the general election, but also their description to us was there's a number of items that they're working on to deal with, you know, we suggested more tables just to move people through, anything that improves the lines from the throughput point of view. They certainly described to us their effort with the tablets as a lookup tool to make sure that people are in the right building, to have large poll sites where they have multiple tables to get the person queued up to the right table, using that tool also, trying to calculate the number of people using those tablets based on size of poll sites. So the bigger you are, you have more resources than say a flat, everybody gets one approach. They certainly were looking to provide that level of service based on size. Some of the general reaction to us was they thought they really wouldn't have a good handle on all of the various things they're looking at least until they got through to the spring primaries next year, because this is a low-volume election for them. They weren't 100% sure they'd be able to engage it.
Bob, to be very short, this is nonsense. All right, you haven't described any approach that will solve the fundamental problem, which is that there will be a huge turnout, relatively, in November of 2016, just as there was in November 2012 and in November 2008 and November 2004, and that I haven't heard anything significant that would bring New York City into compliance with our regulation that requires the county boards to staff their elections in a manner that the lines will not be longer than 30 minutes. So we need to insist that New York City provide us with an explicit plan that will address compliance with our regulation for the November 2016 election. And that requires a number of steps. Frankly, all of these steps are detailed in the report of the Presidential Commission on Election Administration. So this is not rocket science, but it is good election administration. And I don't see New York City on a path to coming into compliance with our regulation. In particular, they're going to need larger spaces in order to add additional tables and in order to add additional personnel to meet the time period, the parts of Election Day would vary from location to location, where there is a crush of voters.
Have they identified which poll sites have, most frequently have this ongoing problem of long waiting lines? Have they done that? Have they given you a list, or is there a list that exists of poll sites in New York City? Because it seems to be a New York City-centric problem.
It is a New York City problem.
That they've identified which poll sites are the ones that have these rather long lines? Have they done that for us or anybody else that you've seen?
There's no, they haven't done, there's no sign, they've provided no numbers indicating in time waits. There's been no study.
So they've never done a study to say, these are the poll sites that have this problem of long waits?
Well, they did, we don't know about it.
Okay. Oh, well, they said
no, they we talked about it, they said they didn't.
We've provided forms to all of our county boards, we've been doing it since 2005, asking them to track voter turnout simply by tracking the public counter number on each scanner on the hour. Your scanner person can do that. If you'd like to talk offline about that phone call, I'd be happy to, but New York City does not use our form, nor do they use anything in its place to track that.
I'm just trying to understand how you fix the problem if you don't know where the problem exists. I mean, you can say it exists in New York City, but where and which poll sites have this problem?
Isn't Doug suggesting that we ask them to give us a report with all this information?
Maybe. I'm assuming that would be part of this, but I'm just sort of curious how we even start talking about this when we don't even know where the problem exists.
See, I think we need to be communicating on a regular basis with them formally, and I think that what we need to do is request that they provide us by a particular deadline, a compliance plan that we can review.
I mean, I think it'd just be helpful to know where this, you know, how extensive is this problem? How many sites have this problem? You know, I don't know how you get that data, frankly, if you haven't been collecting it already. I don't know how you just make it up now. You almost have to do it, I would think, at an election, where you can, you know, have someone sitting there who is monitoring this.
Well, and it really comes from...
But if you have to wait for that, you're going to go to the,
I know,
you know, the 2020 election.
And you don't
want
to do that, I get that. But I think it's hard, to me, it's difficult to really focus in on the issue when you don't know where it exists. So I'm just trying to understand how we even approach this without that data to work on.
Doug, how do you know this exists? How do you know?
Well, because in every general election, there have been very long lines in large numbers of poll sites in New York City. And it's the same problem. It's doing the same thing every year and thinking that that it's going to go away. The Presidential Commission has identified fundamental bases for how to speed the lines. It requires an analysis of how long it takes to process each voter at each step. So, for example, in the New York City process, they themselves call it 1-2-3, that you first go to the table to sign the registration book and get your ballot. Step two is that you go to the booth to fill in your ballot, and step three is that you scan your ballot. Now, everyone knows that step one is the major bottleneck in most New York City poll sites. And there's a sort of step A to get to step one, which is that you have to know what your election district is and get into the right line. So a typical poll site will have anywhere from 5 to 10 election districts in it, and most voters, especially those voting in the in a presidential election, are not going to know what their line is. So you have to be told which line to get into. Now, the time it takes to process a voter in step one of signing the book varies substantially based on the inspector who's sitting at the table. There are good people who can process somebody in 30 seconds or so, and there are, it's not
unknown that that it can take 3 or 4 minutes to process somebody. All right?
You're who?
So you have to know what that time is. But if it takes 30 seconds to process a voter by a good, competent inspector, that means that that inspector can only process perhaps 100 voters an hour. Okay? So if you know that more than 100 voters are going to show up in that hour, that inspector can't handle that number of people.
Have we received any complaints? From anybody but you?
We do get phone calls on election day. The press office has gotten phone calls. We've seen, we've followed New York City's Twitter account during the day where people have...
It is a remarkable thing. Identify the problems in specific areas and give, send us their concept of a solution.
Exactly.
I mean, that's all.
Exactly. And I want to stay on top of this month after month until the city... Until there's an acknowledgement by the city that they have to address this issue.
Well, I think, you know, Bob kind of left off part of the conversation we had with them, that they are acknowledging, and they are clearly stated in that conversation that they have read and reviewed the presidential report and are analyzing the changes in their procedures based upon that report. And you're correct in the bottleneck, and he alluded to the tablets, that step A, so to speak, the traffic cop or the director.
Someone who stands in front of the lines with
the
tablet?
Well, and not just to stand in front of the line, but also to work the line up
and down.
Up and down, so you're not just, hey, building a choke point. They recognize that problem. They do have other issues, which, you know, is a little bit harder to solve, which is having sufficient poll workers, which is always a continual problem for all county boards, and New York City is no exception to that. In addition to the poll sites, I mean, their numbers for voters per poll site based upon their population density are slightly higher than everybody else, but within the parameters of the statute. But that also means much larger poll sites, which they're also trying to coordinate on a separate issue with regards to accessibility.
Right. But the issue is, all right, so now we've identified what the issue is, because you need more poll workers. Yeah. And you need more books.
And divide the books up into smaller chunks.
And you need more space.
Yep.
Okay? So now, what is the city's plan to do that?
Well, that's
So we've identified what the problem is.
Yep.
But I am unaware of any plan that will actually address this between now and November of 2016. And now is the time to be raising these issues. For one thing, the statute requires poll sites be defined in January of next year.
Yeah.
And you know, there are pressures on the city to contract poll sites because of ADA compliance issues.
That's another problem, yeah.
But, for example, they could be doing expanded plans within the public schools, at least for November 2016. Part of the problem is the city uses a one-size-fits-all template for their elections, that they use the same poll site plan for a special election that they, or a, the regular primary election that they use for the presidential election, when the turnout is literally 15 times higher. And they should not be using the same template. They should have a separate template for the presidential election where the turnout is 50% higher than the turnout for an election for governor. And I don't see them doing any of that stuff, and I think it's our job to be pressuring them to do that, and that we need to monitor that.
You know, you say you've identified the problem. Is the presumption that these bottlenecks occur most frequently at the poll sites that contain the most number of EDs?
Often, yes.
So part of the problem being, if I'm a 10 ED poll site, I'm having more problems with lines than if I'm a 4 ED poll site?
In general, I think that's true. But it's not universal.
Fair enough.
I mean, even in my own poll site, which is only 2 election districts, the line for the presidential election was about 2 hours. At least we didn't have a space problem, it was just a line problem, that there were not enough people who could process the 300 people who show up to vote at 8 a.m. on a general election day. And that's just a question of, we know that in November 2016, in my poll site, 300 people are going to show up between 7 a.m. and 8 a.m. to vote. And how are you going to process those 300 people in half an hour? That's the question.
And that gets into, I know when we first started in 2009 with the pilot in 10, we asked counties to start trying to keep track of that per hour turnout so that you could, you can't staff for the average part of the day, because once you fall behind, you're behind for almost, you know, it takes hours to catch up if you've staffed for the average. So you really have to staff that poll site for peak hours, and depending on what part of the state you're in, a suburb or New York City, you busy at when everybody gets out of work? Are you busy before everybody goes to work? Are you in a poll site that is in a retirement, you know, general area, and it's busy mid-afternoon? So you really, that's what we had recommended they do, and in the phone conversation, they really told us they have not used any of that analytical, you know, data collecting, because it, you know, how could they add, you know, figure out how many people are in line? I don't know but generally, if you have that, you know, somehow, at least from the majority of the poll sites, or, you know, the worst of the worst or the biggest, anything, you could then at least figure out, well, I'm a suburban district and everybody goes to work first, and my big crunch is 4 to 7, or in this other area, if they don't vote before they go to work, they're never voting. So that's when everybody shows up. So it's everybody at the beginning part of the day. But we've talked to them about split shifts. If that kind of information shows, you know, maybe you don't need everybody the whole day, you need split shifts so that you can have extra people to work that big long line, and by noon they're gone anyway, so I can get by the rest of the day with an average. So we've talked about all those ideas with Mike and Dawn. Their response is they are understanding of them and they are working on them, but they just don't think, I'm telling you the message, so don't shoot the messenger either, you know, because I want to give them justice to communicate the conversation, that they believe that they're going to try all of these items and some will work better than they've figured out, and they'll make modifications as they go, knowing that this is their slowest election cycle to test some of these things out on. And they really might not know that the test worked until next year. But it's the staffing issue, it's the line issue, it's the other items.
What would it take to loosen up the absentee ballot process?
A lot. Constitutional change.
Is that right? Because that would help.
What would also help, and something that we've been talking about probably since I met Commissioner Kellner, is that we've moved past the idea that a poll site needs to be staffed by election district, and it really needs to be seen as a single unit. So there wouldn't be a line, there wouldn't be a table that you go up to. Maybe there'd be a table that says A through D and E through whatever's next, but you don't have to go to your number table. So I don't have to tell you anything when you walk into the polling place. You just go to the table where you're gonna find your name. And ideally, you know, in my world, you'd have an electronic poll book that's got a little printer, and once you're checked in, you get your little token. You go to the ballot distribution table to make sure that the person giving out ballots gives out the right ballot. The choke point is not at the scanners, and it's not at the privacy booths. You wouldn't have a choke point at a line going to an ED table because you're not going to one anymore. And you could have enough people, qualified people, staffing a ballot distribution table that would hand out all the ballots, the right ballots to the right voters within that poll site. And we just haven't gotten there in a change in statute or a change in mindset. And ideally, that would solve problems for a lot of county boards, not just New York City. We don't have line problems in other counties, but certainly we have staffing issues and poll sites without enough space. And if you're trying to cram 3 EDs into a poll site that's not big enough, why should you have to do that? 3 EDs is 12 people plus.
Well, let me just ask a kind of basic question. Why do we have line problems in New York City but nowhere else? Unique about, I mean, we know New York City's different, but what is different about, you know, one thing I think I brought up, which I think is different, is the number of EDs and poll sites. My experience in New York City is when you go down to an election, it's not unusual to walk into a poll site that has 8, 10 EDs. Upstate, that's very unusual. Upstate, you might have 3, 4, some have 1. So you don't have large numbers of people congregating at a single poll site. So in my experience, that's one unique characteristic of New York City. What's the solution to that? I guess find more poll sites. I don't know. But, you know, I can see that. Are there other unique characteristics to New York City's elections that cause these bottlenecks in New York City that we just don't see upstate?
There used to be with the voter cards that they would have to fill out before voters voted, but they eliminated those. To their credit, we had discussed it with them, and they did eliminate them. There was some reticence on the part of not the management team in New York City, but others, but they did get rid of them, and those have eliminated a lot of, have eliminated that reason from the pool of reasons that there are lines. I don't know how else to answer your question, because I don't get it. I mean, in Erie, Onondaga, our bigger counties, Albany, we certainly have poll sites that have more than a couple of EDs being served in them, but we do not have those lines or those choke points, certainly not lines longer than 30 minutes. I mean, granted, if you go to Buffalo at 8 in the morning and you're trying to vote before you go to work, you're going to see a lot of people in that poll site because their polls do open at 6. But I don't see it, and I know they think I'm incapable of seeing it, so I'll just leave it at that.
What we hear is some of it is the available sites. They get an available site and they squeeze in as many people in that geographic area because they say they can't get another site that's accessible. The most recent court case against them for accessible polling sites kind of have, you know, they have to go back to the court on some of those items when they move a site or move an ED to a different site to make sure what they're moving into is equally as accessible. So they're kind of have this federal, you know, situation, which is accessible sites, and so far, it's accessible, but is the path of travel work for that many people? And where else can they find a site? So some of it is site, you know, where do they pick what's available in that geographic area for that many people?
I mean, I think absent Commissioner Kellner, who might live there, I think it's very difficult for all of us to opine on the difficulties that a board in an election the magnitude of New York City would have, and that's probably why they should tell us what their rationale is.
Right. So what my request now is that we send the city a request that they provide us a plan, say by September 30th, to indicate how they plan to come into compliance with our regulation. I think it's 62-10-19.
I think they should give us a description of the problem as they see it. In case it's just 5 districts or 10.
Yeah, I mean, I admit, I hear this anecdotally myself. I think we all do. You know, we've all heard over the years, when I was here, I heard it over the years, anecdotal evidence of long lines, which is, I'm sure it's true. But again, I've never seen this. Mm-hmm. Here are the poll sites that have these chronic problems that we need to fix.
But you get an area where it's where challenged people can make it, and then they have to wait 2 hours? I mean, if that's a problem,
That's a problem.
It's not solving the other problem.
Yeah.
Are we talking about a poll site? If you pick one particular area, we're talking about a poll site where all of the, you have all the, let's say 8 different EDs. Are all those 8 EDs voting for the same set of elected officials?
Possible.
Congress and so forth.
Not necessarily,
but it's possible.
But you were saying before, in other words, in instances where you can, you could combine various EDs, which are voting, that's a big undertaking, I would think, are voting for the same set of elected officials, correct?
Even if they weren't, the poll
you have to get them the correct ballot. You can. Most states do, outside of New York State, most places vote by poll site, even though not everybody at the poll site may have the same list of candidates. And then the inspectors have to give the voter the correct ballot, which in New York City, they claim, is not feasible.
Risky.
Right.
I'm sorry, what?
Risky.
Risky, that the correct ballot, if you have different ballots being handed out by the same person, that they would hand the correct ballot to the correct voter.
Well, that's why I mentioned the token idea, that it's harder to do that when you're looking at a little slip of paper that says this is ED1, AD whatever. It's kind of hard to screw that up. Not that it couldn't happen, but it's a lot less likely, because now there's a, you know, there's a little more accountability for that task and just me telling you what district I'm in. I can forget while I'm online where somebody's telling me what district I'm in by the time I get to where I have to sign in and then go to a table to get a ballot, I will have forgotten again.
Absolutely. I agree.
And certainly the 2012 election with the governor's
that was an aberration. Yeah. I mean, with Hurricane Sandy and everything really impacted things. I get that, but this has been an ongoing problem, though. This isn't
absolutely
like it just
this
popped up this
and
year.
It isn't just Sandy, but it's interesting that New York City had the problem, but not Nassau and Westchester.
I agree.
So it wasn't a Sandy. It wasn't unique to Sandy.
If you look at an election cycle, busy when you hear of a one or a two, but there's some explanation as to what happened in that district, and when we reach out to talk to that county, depending on when we hear of the problem on election day, you know, what resources are you getting there? But it's usually some, you know, lights went out, they had a bomb scare somewhere, or, the machine, you know, they had to bring a new machine, so there was a bit of a line for that period of time. But it's isolated to that set of facts, and they make sense, and they're all emergency, you know, trying to deal with it. In New York City, we get the most issues of the breadth of the boroughs.
In Manhattan, which is not the case in the outer boroughs, people vote on their way to work. And the times when people are going to work changes by neighborhood. In upper-income neighborhoods, people tend to go to work later in the morning, and in lower-income neighborhoods, people go to work earlier in the morning. So, but it's pretty clear that you can tell where the bottlenecks are going to be. The problem is the city board is still in the mentality of we have one size fits all, but it isn't. You have a crush of people voting at a particular time in the morning, and you have to be able to service them. All right, well, look, I don't mean to prolong this.
No, that's okay.
My request would be at this point that the commissioners make a request to the New York City Board of Elections that it provide us with a written plan by September 30th on how the New York City Board plan, or how the Board of Elections in the City of New York plans to be in compliance with Regulation 6210.19. I think it's C.
Yeah, but also the scope of the problem. I think you should ask what they perceive as the scope of the problem.
All right. I believe Commissioner Kellner is making a motion. Is someone making a note as to exactly what this motion is so that we have that?
All right. And I accept Commissioner Spano's friendly amendment, so that it's that the Board of Elections in the city define the scope of the problems and present a plan on how they intend to comply with Regulation 6210.19C.
And we're asking for that by the end of September?
Obviously.
Okay, we have a motion.
Yeah.
The second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay.
Thank you.
So someone should transmit that to the city board. I assume the two executive directors will take care of that and let them know that we are looking for certainly more information from them and a plan. Now, Anna, I think we're still on your report.
Well, I think we're done.
Are we done? Okay, I wasn't sure if we were done or not.
We're good. Brendan, did you want to elaborate on anything?
I have a couple of things to bring up, but I think they'll be in the context of the item on the agenda.
Oh, okay.
We can talk about that a little bit more, though. Okay, so that's the elections operations report. We now move on to NVRA PIO. I noticed John Conklin's not here. Tom Connolly will be handling that, I assume?
Thank you, Commissioner. The Public Information Office has obviously been busy with media and public inquiries about a number of the topics that have already been discussed, including ballot access, the recent campaign finance filing, the presidential primary legislation, and also the recent vacancies in offices. In addition, John and I have also participated in the interviewing process for the candidates for the top CIO position at the agency. And we continue to participate in the meetings regarding the various technology projects, the NICE voter refresh, the Capus Vitus redesign, and any of the other legacy systems that we're bringing over to the new platform. We did, on the website, post the positions.
I'm sorry, can I kind of interrupt right there? Because I just want to, would you be the appropriate one to talk a little bit about the upgrade to the systems that we're going through, or would that be better off handled through the ITU?
I think he would probably prefer that I answer them, so that's fine. I have absolutely no problem. I'd be happy to answer.
I just wanted to kind of elaborate on that.
Sure.
Just a little bit.
I'll be happy to answer any questions.
Well, I don't know if I have questions, but I think a little more detail on that is helpful to me. So we're going through this process of updating the Capus/FITUS system, as we call it, which is really the list of candidates and then their campaign finance filings. And so in doing so, we're going to change the software, change the whole process people use to make their, I'm really most interested here in the campaign finance filings.
Okay.
And I'm assuming we're also going to change what the public sees on our website for purposes of viewing these documents.
Right.
And I'm trying to understand what that is. So I'm just trying to get a little better feel for what these changes are going to be. I know they're a ways off, because I understand this isn't going to happen till next year, well into next year sometime from the time frames I've seen. And I guess I have a question of why it's taking so long to begin with. But that said, I understand this stuff's not simple. But so one of the changes that I think was alluded to earlier was, it's no longer going to be impossible for people to see an amended form. Is that correct? So if I do a campaign finance filing and I amend it, currently I can't see the previous form. I can only see the newly updated amended form, and I cannot see what was originally filed. Is that going to be changed now? Am I now going to be able to see what the original filing was and the amendment to? Or how's that going to work?
We would have access to both. I mean, right now, if an individual from the public wanted to see an original filing, they could. They could request that of us, and the IT department would provide that to us, and we would often give that out as a FOIL request.
But that'd be a FOIL now. So yeah. This would address that needing to get a FOIL to see the old filing and then looking online to see the new one. You could see both.
Right.
Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. And then, so I think that's good if we're gonna make that change. Now, as far as how people file, let me just understand that for a second. Right now, if I'm doing a filing, there is software that does it, helps me with it. But what it is basically is it's almost a PDF. How many schedules now? 16, 18, 20? I don't know. Maybe somebody knows. Schedules that I use to file. Whatever A through R is. Whatever that number is. So if I want to file a corporate, I do it on this schedule. If I want to do a partnership, I do it here. If I want to do it, I have to do all these different schedules. And if I, is that still going to be the case? Am I still going to be using schedules, or am I just going to put down, you know, ABC Corp, $4,000. I don't have to put it on any particular schedule. I just put it as a income, money coming in. I identify it as a corporation. Identify the entity, address, all that's still there. But I don't have to necessarily go to Schedule B in order to do it. I can just do it on income, outgo. Is that how it's going to work now, or not necessarily?
I would leave that to compliance to
okay,
to speak to that.
Okay, and I don't mean to put you on the spot.
No, that's fine. I mean, with regard to the information that we have, the idea of building the web-based system and building a system that's been in place, improving a system that's been in place for a number of years, we obviously will avail ourselves where possible of the functionality that to kind of, you know, diminish the amount of redundant work that treasurers have.
Not just redundant work, Tom. I think what it leads to is mistakes. I think what happens is you have a lot of people who put the wrong entry on the wrong schedule because they don't realize, oh, that should have been on Schedule B, not Schedule A. And it just leads to errors. But they're that was the wrong schedule error. It's the information's there. Everybody knows what it is. They just didn't look at Schedule B to find it. Why do I have to, you know, I guess from an outside guy, why do I have to look at Schedule B at all? I should just be able to look at candidate X. I want to see where his money came from. I should just see it. And it should just list it for me. I shouldn't have to go from Schedule A to Schedule B to Schedule C to find it. I should be able to just look and find it. There it is. I want to see where his money went. I look at this and there it went. But I don't know why I have to continue this schedule search, which to me is complicated, leads to errors by people filing, and leads, in my mind, to more work and maybe misunderstanding from the people who are viewing it because they don't realize how all these different schedules work.
Well, unless you want to look up an aggregate corporations or aggregate, you know.
And you should be able to do that.
In a digital format, you should be able to.
You should be able to do that. I should be able to just go in and say, show me all the corporate contributions to candidate X.
Right.
Bang, there it is.
Right, but we're talking about doing that. And I mean, I don't want to misspeak because I'm not the technical person here. But in the various phases that we've talked about moving this along, the first phase was really, really fundamental questions. And my understanding is as we develop the two additional phases, which it almost seems like two of them are being combined now, more detail will be worked out. In other words, it's been getting rolled out with the decision making as the work actually has to happen. But I certainly understood, and correct me if I'm wrong, that the searching opportunities are going to be vastly expanded. I mean, I think part of the issue with the schedules is that certain committees use certain schedules and other committees don't.
Correct.
So if you're looking up information on a PAC or on a party committee, there's only certain information that is actually required for that type of committee. So the schedules, my understanding is a way to, it's just an organizational method, because if you're a PAC and you need these four schedules, you're not also filing these other three schedules, so to speak. So I think the schedules are organizational, but you should still be able to search in a global kind of way.
Yeah, no, just to clarify what I was saying before is that I think that the schedules, for the most part, my understanding, aren't going away from the filing standpoint, but from the public standpoint, looking at the information itself, they will have far more robust. And even though we may present them with the schedule information like we do now, they will always have the opportunity.
Well, I'm going to just ask that you look at those schedules.
Sure.
And you make a decision whether those schedules are actually needed. I mean, my view is, notwithstanding, you know, what you're saying, Kathleen, I understand it. I don't know that you need that for that purpose, you know, for organizational purposes. I mean, I think I could organize my, for example, contributions on one schedule, but I would have to identify what type of
like
contribution
with the
they are.
Like a field.
Right, like a P for partnership, C for corporation, I for individual, A for association, whatever you come up with. But it doesn't have to be on four different schedules based on that. It could all be on one schedule. Just within that schedule, you identify what type of entity it is, because they have different limits and different rules, and that's all legit. And we need to track them. But you don't have to make the filer jump around from schedule to schedule during their filings. And then if they make a mistake, oh, that should have been on the corporate, not on the individual. You made a mistake. You know, you just all have them on one. You know
just
what I'm saying?
I know we met on the business. I think we understand what you want us to look at. I think in general, if you had 10 checks, we were envisioning the new system, they would be able to put one in after the other with a pull down to describe it, and then
right.
It would go where it needs to go.
But why does it need to go somewhere else?
Well, wherever.
That's my basic
question.
Well,
the searchability on that.
No, there is a good reason for that,
okay.
What Bob is saying. And we've talked about this definitely in the meetings where, say, according to, you know, your model, you have P for partnership, mm-hmm. And then there would be, if you put the P in there, a drop-down menu that would then say, you know, over 2,500, mm-hmm. Name the partners, mm-hmm. Kind of thing. Name the partners and attribute.
Mm-hmm.
So some things, it's like a computer tree. You get to this, and if you've indicated a certain thing, then another question appears. Mm-hmm. We have definitely talked about that kind of type of website, because it's what people are used to. When you get on and use Amazon or whatever, that's the kind of...
No, I think we should be more like those sites. I agree with you. I think that should be our goal, is to be more like Google or whatever to, you know, if I put in a 5 or 6 characters that has a drop-down of who meets that, so I don't have to have an exact spelling of a name in order to find that name. You know, it should be easier to search. I agree with that. And I'm hoping we're going to actually, I should say, that we're going to get there with that type of search mechanism.
And one of the other things also is throughout the way, we identified initially 3 basic groups: the consumer group, the people who are kind of looking at the information online, the filers, and then also more the kind of the county candidate information for Capus Vitus and the whole thing. But we are also trying to involve them in the process as we go forward. I mean, obviously, we're going to have a beta group. We've invited some previous beta testers to the opportunity to offer some of their comments at different benchmarks in the different phases of the project. And we'll be doing the same thing with the consumer group, so people will be looking at that information. So, you know, once we're at a point where we're looking at moving forward with a certain, you know, plan, we'll probably present that to the individual group to request some additional feedback, just in case, you know, we're not developing it in a vacuum, and we're getting a little bit more input from people who are actually using that system.
So where are we in the process now as far as developing the system itself and answering these types of questions of what it's actually going to look like and how it's going to be interfacing with either, you know, candidates or the public? Where are we in that? When does that start, or has it started, and are we making a list then of what we want to see in this system to give to the software developer to say this is what we've decided we want our system to do, now you make it happen, or whoever does this?
We do have ongoing meetings, and that was largely the part of the steering committee, which consists of a number of people from every unit these systems touch. We've had those conversations with the project manager for the project. We've had conference calls with some of those groups that I mentioned before, kind of giving them a quick overview of what the outside project's going to be. As far as the actual structure of the development of the project, that has changed somewhat from the initial phases, largely due to there have been some holdups largely with the migration of the data from the old legacy system into the new system. And so as opposed to just kind of waiting for that to be completed, the project manager has recommended making some changes here and there as far as developing other aspects of the system so that we're not stopping. So, I mean, I don't know, Bill, do you have anything to add on?
Well, actually, one thing I was going to point out, we're actually looking to try to consolidate the project down into a single release instead of a phase release. That means the front end that they basically finished the coding on would not be released until the rest of the tools were released. We want to do that only because the tools that we would need to do a phased release. The initial plan was phased release, put the first part out and keep the systems in sync with some software and some coding behind it. We investigated the tools recommended by ITS, and the tools and the consulting to get that done was quoted at just about $1 million to do that. And that seems to be cost prohibitive to do that. Whereas if we do a single large release, we eliminate that cost without negatively, it has to be not negatively impacting the final end date that the entire project is done. We're not going to slow things down by going with a single release. It just means we keeping the old system alive a little bit longer.
Fair enough. I mean, I'll leave that to you, I guess. I'm just trying to understand what I'm going to see once it's done. I don't really understand the technical aspect of this, to be honest about it. So, if you have a better way to release it, that's fine with me. But I'm interested primarily in, you know, how are the users, how are the candidates going to interface with this, and then what are the people, the public, going to see?
Okay.
I'm interested in both ends of that, and if you could help me understand that as you go through it, I'd appreciate it.
Okay. And Commissioner, I want to endorse your comments on trying to keep the filing as simple as possible and to minimize the amount of detail. I thought your comments on that were helpful.
Okay. Sorry, that's all I had.
No, that's fine.
Do you have more time on your report?
Just a couple things more, just that obviously we had posted reports of the petitions that were filed here for the 2015 primary.
We do continue working with the counties and other states with regard to the cross-check and the military NCOA information. We will be working with the counties that will be having primaries in September with regard to their military ballots that have to be uploaded. The 32-day transmittal deadline for that is going to be August 9th. So we'll be making sure that they have their ballots into the system that we have in place for the military voters. And then I think, other than that, Greg and Patrick have visited six counties in the last month, and they're actually at a seventh one today. And I think that's all I have for us this month.
Okay, great. Thank you. Any questions? Next is ITU. Bill, do you have?
We've basically already covered everything I want to. Caps Fitus, the other major project we've got going on is a nice voter refresh. Since the last meeting, Work Order 3 was signed and put into place. Work Order 3 lets us use some unallocated hours, hours that were not allocated to original tasks, to start working on the implementation of the virtual infrastructure. Let's just get the project rolling again while we're working on the project amendment to add the hours that the funding was approved for during the last board meeting. Once that's done, we'll be able to finalize our schedules and get the infrastructure and the new version of the application ready to go. We don't have an exact date. We're going to keep it as close as we can to the original date, but we did lose some time while trying to write up the Work Order 3 and the amendments.
I'm sorry, I don't mean to go back. Back to my previous issue. Do we have a time? What is our end date for getting that new system?
We had an end date of December. We are probably going to slip a little bit.
December of?
Excuse me, this year. The end.
I'm not talking Knights Voter now.
Sorry.
I'm back on.
Oh, sorry.
My time.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry.
I apologize. No, the
Capus Fitus
system. Do we have a time frame for that one? For when that might be finished?
December of next year.
December of next year.
Okay.
All right. Go ahead.
And the other significant update is where we've got most of the hardware and software delivered. The only major piece still outstanding is the server rack for the Nano Center, and that we expect within the next week or two.
Any questions? No.
I think it's. I. Sorry.
That's all right.
I know I mentioned at the last meeting we were concerned about the funding for these projects and the money that
are
is
we
in
always?
The. Well, we were nervous we didn't have enough, and we're not clear that we won't have enough. But we did have a conversation with the Division of Budget, Todd and I, and the IT people. Their expectation is a couple of things. They rolled some of the unspent money from the last fiscal year, some of the things we bought right at April at the beginning, they used last year's budget for. So it was about $600,000 out of the $1.3 million. So that will not be eaten out of this year's allocation or appropriation. So we had that full appropriation for this fiscal year, and they said we should, at least for planning purposes, expect that same number in the next fiscal year. So with that in mind, certainly Bill and the staff are working up what they think the expectations are, the analysis of how to keep all these systems limping along, because $1 million is a lot of money to spend just for a phased release. But I think we're a lot more comfortable that we should be able to at least meet the, you know, pay for the things we're thinking of doing.
Well, is the phased release in order to keep the old system running while you're putting the new system out?
Well, we have to keep the old system running, and there's
yeah.
a cost to do that anyway.
Yeah.
So we've been trying to figure out, is it cheaper, from their analysis, was it originally cheaper, they thought, in order to turn it over to the new system sooner? I think based on the review, no, it might not be cheaper. It's going to cost us something to keep them going until the new computer program is up and running, but we keep going back and forth on a number of factors. It's going to cost us money. What is the cheapest option?
Well, I guess
also,
there's
what's
that,
a better
but there's
option?
Also, I mean, I guess the only other concern I have is that we don't want to scrap the old one until we know the new one works. So
just,
I guess that's my only
concern. Our biggest costs are things like Oracle, where they're no longer supported, so getting the type of help at a level of someone that knows how to keep Oracle limping along is expensive, and some of the other solutions are equally expensive or more expensive. So we're looking at a number of things that hopefully will take, you know, we don't want to spend money just band-aiding to keep it going. if that money could be better spent on the development of the new program. But they're trying to come up with a happy medium, and I think they're close to recommending one to us.
Okay. Anything else? No? Okay, then last is enforcement. Risa Sugarman.
Thank you, Commissioner. As Kim and Kathleen said, we've met to discuss better relationships between compliance and the enforcement unit, and we are working towards working on referrals and discussing how we can better access information from the compliance unit to better access enforcement information so that we can move forward on our investigations. We also are receiving calls daily on this election cycle from candidates all over the state. We are sometimes referring, we also get emails sometimes referring those to compliance and sometimes answering those questions as best we could for the candidates if there are enforcement issues. We had one of my investigators left the office, and it's my estimation that it would be better for me to have an additional auditor, so I've been doing interviews of another auditor instead of an investigator, and I think I have found a candidate, so we're moving forward on that. We're continuing to conduct our investigations and moving forward with a process to begin to file both more criminal requests for more criminal referrals and more litigation on failures to file. It's, as you know, since we've discussed it at prior meetings, been a long process for me to make a decision on how I'm going to go forward with that. I think I've reached my process of how I'm going to do that. In the last several months, we've been looking at the asked for a report from Capus Fidus. There are certain reports that we can access on both the 2012 through 2014 failures to file, which are the lawsuits that have been filed previously by enforcement in the previous administration. We've also accessed or created an Excel file for those who have failed to file in the January periodic. One of my investigators used an Excel to access those candidates' committees who failed to file in the January periodic and made a comparison from the reports that we accessed to the previous lawsuits that were filed and the January failures to file. And in the Excel that we created, the majority of those on the January failure to file list had been sued several times in the past by the previous enforcement counsel. So what we're going to do is to establish certain targeted groups. Those who have been sued multiple times before, and look at those groups for requests for criminal referrals if those are appropriate. We're going to look at those candidates that are office holders that are failing to file both their periodics and their the election cycle, and look at those asking why they're failing to file if they're in office, and see if they've been sued, or if not, to do that and get those $10,000 fines that we would be able to do. And we're also going to look at targeted groups of those committees where, if they were in public office and are no longer in public office, what are the statuses of their campaigns? If they're still spending money, why are they spending money? If they're not in office, and if they're doing that, are they doing it appropriately? and if they're not, consider criminal referral requests to the commissioners. And once we get the July periodic list, to again make that comparison, but first to send out a letter using not only the lists that are provided by compliance, but also the returns of the postcards that Kathleen mentioned that were sent out, so that we can access that list and create a list that we can do a batch review to get updated addresses and send a letter to those who have failed to file or those who have bad addresses and saying, this is what we're looking to do, file now, or you're going to be either go to civil litigation or criminal referral. And that's what the process is. It's my position, and that's why that I wanted to look at this more closely, is to look at a targeted list as opposed to just to sue, you know, just one after another. So that we're going to use both the targeted lists that the prior enforcement counsel used to do those filings, plus other investigative tools that we've developed.
Other questions?
Is that the end of your report?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much. And I think we are then done with unit updates. And next on our agenda is old business. And I don't have anything listed under old business. So I guess we'll move on to new business. New business are the petition rulings. And I have before me, and I believe all the commissioners do, a staff report on this year's designating petitions that were, I believe, either challenged or found to be deficient by the staff. Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay, so why don't we do this?
I would just adopt the report.
Yeah, I mean, do you want to do these individually, or I mean, what's your pleasure?
Typically, we've been doing the whole report.
Just do it. Just
the only
do the
question
report.
Is whether any of these are significant enough to read out loud, but I don't think there are.
So I have 1, 2, 3, 4 that were invalid as prima facie, meaning they didn't have enough signatures or were over designated. Uh-huh. Or no AD, so there's a prima facie problem with the petition itself. And then I have 1, 2, 3 that were specced out.
Correct.
Now we're only invalidating though. I noticed there's some valids on here. So do we vote on the valids and the invalids, or just?
I move that we adopt the staff report
as it stands. We have a motion to adopt the staff report as it's presented with both valids and invalids on it. So
second.
I have a second. So we have a second. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? All right. I guess that's the end of that. So that's the new business. I'm sorry, there's another piece of new business, and that is the resolution to permit testing of an upgrade of the Dominion Voting System's central count system. And that, I guess I want a little, I want to go into this just a little bit, if we can. So this is a...
I'm going to sit up here and... We're going to punt to Bob at some point.
I think just a little explanation would be helpful here.
Is there an actual resolution?
Yeah, I have it right here. Do you have that?
No, but I'll find it.
You can read mine.
All right, thank you.
So this is a resolution to allow, as I understand it, the Dominion Central Count System to go into testing.
Right.
Correct? So this is the system that's used by how many boards?
13
boards in the state, and that just is to count their affidavit absentee ballots at the central location. There's no poll site system in play here at all. These are the new systems Anna alluded to earlier. These are all new. These have been purchased in the last
year and a half.
Okay, and so they're relatively new, and so they're all still under maintenance. Okay, and I guess I just have a couple. So why are they updating it already, since it just was purchased a year ago? That'd be number one. But number two, maybe you could go through what the updates are. So if you could, that's, those are my really two questions.
Sure. The reason for the updates that are presented are all usability type things. These are items that the counties have reported back to Dominion that would be nice if the system could do this and you know, do these additional things, such as the ability to...
I don't want to such as, Bob. I would like a complete list of all the changes they're proposing to make.
Yes. The first one, the ability to delete batches. Currently, you can't delete a single batch. A batch would be scanning a set of ballots in that pertain to a particular ED. Every time you scan a batch in, or scan the ballots in, it creates a separate batch. You can't currently delete a batch if you make a mistake. You have to delete the project and start over from the beginning. So this will give the counties the ability, if they make a mistake with a particular batch, to go ahead and just delete that batch and redo that one batch. So that would, that's what that change is for. The other change is for the graceful recovery from a paper jam. Currently, if you have a paper jam in the system, you don't save that batch when the paper jam occurs, but you have to rescan all the ballots that have already been scanned to create a new batch. So this will allow them to recover at that point and just continue scanning after they resolve the paper jam. The one for the stop on ballot from incorrect ED. Currently, if there's a ballot in the batch that doesn't belong to that particular ED, the system will put it in a separate bucket, and then the county has to go through and manually allocate that ballot to the correct ED. This way, the system will stop if it encounters an incorrect ED, and they can decide to pull that out or let it run through. The automatically obtained ED codes. The ED codes are like electronic header cards, and currently they have to key those in. Now the system will read them directly from the memory card, so they would just select them at that point. And the others are just updates to reports that were in the system currently.
What do you mean updates to reports? What does that mean?
Well, the reports didn't totally mirror the reports they would get out of the central or the precinct by the EMS system. So they would have to take the memory card, bring it to the EMS, read them in, and print the results, or print the reports from there instead of printing them directly from the central count system.
Okay, so it's to conform them to the...
Yes.
Okay. So those are all the changes?
Yes.
That this would be. And so as I understand it, if we approve this, this would then allow this change to go into testing?
To start the certification process.
And then we certify it, assuming the testing is shows it works?
Yes.
And once we certify it as usable, then it comes back to us to then permit the counties to actually put it onto their system?
Yes.
Okay. Now, who pays for this testing?
The vendor.
The vendor pays for it, so there's no state money being used for this. So it's only 13 counties that use this, then?
At present.
At present, okay. I guess those are all my questions. Anybody else have questions?
I move the resolution.
I have a motion. I have a second.
Second.
Second, and all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed. And the resolution is adopted.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Now, I presume at some point, not to belabor this either, but we are going to see a similar request for poll site machine updates?
Yes. The Dominion has already submitted it, but we tabled that, and ES&S is going to submit one next month.
Okay, so we will be seeing a similar request for those systems to be tested as well?
The Dominion one we have, we just separated this piece out to keep the project moving forward, but we're in the context of separating it out, that issue of version management and, and that kind of thing comes up. So we'll hopefully, Brendan and I will have a recommendation for the board at the next meeting, and then you could vote on the balance of the Dominion upgrade, and if we get ES&S's application on time for your consideration, you'd have that as well.
Now, these upgrades are being generated by the counties. Is that fair to say? They're the ones asking for this stuff. Dominion's not coming in to say, let's fix it. It's the counties saying, we want this, and Dominion's accommodating them with these upgrades?
In the case of Dominion, yes. It's really just a change in the way the tape prints out on the precinct-based system.
I mean the ones we even adopted today.
Yes, this is all from, this is county feedback.
County
In the case of ESNS, when they submit theirs, it's mostly county requests, but there's some additional items that ESNS wants to put in their system.
Okay. So I think that's that. Now, I don't have any other business for the meeting. If someone wants to make a motion to go into executive session, I believe we have both enforcement cases to discuss and litigation to discuss.
You want to set a date for our next meeting?
Oh, yeah, sure, we can. Yeah, hang on. Let's take a look here. What do we have as far as?
We're talking about the last week of August or the first week of September, and then
September
28th of September.
Oh, you want to set two meetings? Okay.
The 28th seems to be an agreed date that's the best day when we have to certify the primary results.
Well, that is the certification deadline, so.
All the JD certificates would be filed, so if there's any issues with those, you'd have to contend with them, and then we could certify.
Well, let's set the next one at least. I have to look at my calendar, but let's set the next one at least, and then we can talk about, I'm certainly happy to talk about the September one as well. But do you have a date for the next one? Do you guys have a, is there a need to meet by a certain date?
The only need would be the after the 15th of September and before the 28th.
But I was thinking of meeting before then.
No,
I'm sorry, so, are you on September or are we on?
We're on the end of August, beginning of
September. I think you pick a day in the last week of August or the first week of September.
Okay, let's do that. Let's pick something.
Whatever works for you. I think Commissioner Spano and I looked already and we're available.
You're pretty good.
Any of those
I think I can do that too. I think I'm good. I mean, do you have a preference? It's here.
Doesn't matter.
Anybody here? When's Labor Day?
Seventh.
Okay. Why don't we meet the week? Can you meet like September 1st? It's a Tuesday. Does that?
That's fine.
Fit
that's
you?
Fine.
How about if we shoot for September 1st?
It's a Tuesday, right?
That's Tuesday, the 1st.
And just for your planning before you for the next meeting.
Yeah.
The 28th is our certification deadline.
Okay.
We need you to meet in case there are any filing issues for the new political parties or from the judicial conventions.
Okay.
Even though some of the filings may come after your meeting, we can't control the fact that we can get a declination afterwards that may need your.
So it doesn't have to be the 28th, but that's probably.
That's the most productive since.
The best date. Okay. All right, well, let's try for it. I just got to look at a couple things before I go that far out. But I can certainly commit to the 1st, so we'll do that, and then at the 1st, we'll commit to the next one. How's that? Okay. Thank you. I guess that's the end. I don't expect to come back out. Do you expect to come back out of session? So I think we're done for the public. We had a very low turnout today. Public.
Tom, can you make this thing work?
Yeah.
So, thank you. Yeah, sure. We can take a 2-minute break if you need one, and we'll reconvene at 2:05.